one of the tallest structures in the world. I had the pleasure of visiting myself during construction and when it was finished. It's one of the most amazing architectural structures that, as far as I understand, also really well loved by the local community and embraced as a new landmark for the city Guangzhou. So Mark is going to describe the project also through a short documentary about the development process, and to introduce a book that was recently published, that was written by himself and his partner Barbara Kuit. Maybe the most interesting quote from the introduction is that existing legislation and working methods failed to satisfy the development of a building of this size and height. So the methodology was very much developed as a prototypical process, very much as the building itself, and while the development and construction was going on. So the very unique nature is the topic of the lecture. Just a very quick background information on Mark's biography. He studied at the Technical University of Delft and also at the AA here in London. He conducted independent research in Africa and Asia with grants from the Netherlands Foundation for Visual Arts, Design, and Architecture. Taught as a unit master between 1999 and 2008, and received the Riba Bronze Medal Tutor Award in 2003. Since 1998, he and Barbara Kuit founded the office. It's called Information-Based Architecture, which was originally founded in London and now operates from Amsterdam since 2003, and has been also working directly in based in Guangzhou in China. It's my pleasure to welcome, and please welcome Mark Hemel.
Okay, hi. I'm just going to present basically my book, which is for us like a documentation of like a really interesting project, quite an amazing project to get it quite early on in your career. We basically started our office in 1998. And already like in 2004, we stumbled into this scale project. So like, it was like a lot of improvisation, a lot of students, ex-students, colleagues that helped out during the competition and after, in order to kind of work out our design. And this whole process, like we also liked, also because of the kind of the exceptional nature of this project, we like to have documented in this book, which a little bit later we'll read a little piece of it. This book is actually made to be read, like most architectural books. Many architecture books are there like as coffee table books or too much jargon and therefore difficult to get to the end. We try to actually describe it in a way that you can actually read it and basically get the point, like so. If I go just a little bit back to the process, like 2004 was the 4 years before the Beijing Olympics. At that time, the Bush Dubai was not really built yet. It was under construction, and Taipei 101 was really the biggest tower at that time. Some of our students from the Guangzhou area were in my unit at that time when I was teaching in the AA, and they told me that this was really like a competition that was being talked about like for many years in the area. And that there was really an expectation that they wanted to have something special. I myself was in Guangzhou for the first time in 1995, and at that time it was really like quite a dirty city. nothing special, but you felt like the dynamic of it. Lots of projects going on everywhere, but it was nothing particular yet. When we came across this competition, we were kind of like thinking, on the one hand, we should keep it really simple, and we should do something with the specifics of the brief, which was like a tower, a tall tower, so do something with the structure. So that the structure would be, on the one hand, like very logical, but on the other hand, maybe be more refined than it usually is. It also, since there was no program given, no particular things of what had to be in the tower, we had to develop that all ourselves. Like we also had the possibility to make the tower kind of like inside out, where the structure would be on the outside and the program inside, but also the facade on the inside. So that maybe like with an, where like most most buildings you have on the outside a surface that kind of like makes it into a volume, it would be possible to make something that is more transparent, that would have more layers of ways of kind of more like a veil, more like a structural layers that could be peeled off slowly. At the same time, the project was like based on like on a central axis, yeah, new central axis that they were planning, and it had to also to be something for the whole city. Yeah, there were like, it was a special location on the south side of the river, and this whole new bend like was kind of like was erased, and kind of now new competitions were going on for line after line of projects. And therefore, it also had to be something that would resonate in some way with the kind of local culture, with the and kind of like live up to the ambitions of the city. Like the, it is quite an an area which is quite wealthy, but they have never really showed their wealth at, up to that point, and then. In 2010, it was they got the Asian Games as a big event, and they wanted to do something special for this city. So they planned a new opera house, a new museum, and also several new office towers and this TV tower on the south. So this whole band in the middle was erased and like. And kind of projects being planned for this whole area. If I just show you a little bit like what our, how do you click on, there's no mouse or whatever. If I want to start this, like, oh, yeah, no, it doesn't work. Like there's no click here on this, oh yeah, doesn't work. Okay, I'll skip it. No problem. So, just on the other opposite side of the river, you can see Zaha's Opera House, Wilkinson Ayers West Tower, and on the other side, Rocco Yim's New Guangdong Museum. That's here, and. Here's a new library that they have started, and this is all going to be one major park. And underneath the ground, there's like one big shopping center organized all the way from an existing shopping center here at the back, that is like in this area, all the way here till underneath the tower. And there's a light railway that they put underneath in order to connect it all. So. Also, our project was kind of linked with a rail, with a metro system, with a light railway, and became part of this whole band. What we wanted to do is like to create that. If I go back to this one is best to see is to have a simple structural system that on one hand like brings the forces down to the ground, and on the other hand like creates a rotation, and that is like an urban relationship where the top is basically rotated towards the northwest and towards the southeast, which is kind of the direction of the Pearl River Delta. And on the and the other part of the building is basically more orientated towards the north-south axes. And this, and then at the very top, we made an open air deck, which would then kind of like open up a view, kind of framed by the top ring, towards the northwest, the more of the old center of the city. So, and therefore kind of like connecting all these different parts, these urban parts of the city together. So this was like the kind of like under construction, the idea that you would have like in the end, like a kind of landscape at the top that could be climbed and which was not, which would have only a small railing. We made it basically a jumping zone, a suicide jumping zone here, like you see. But it's just a simple thing, like by doing a 3 meter setback, you don't need like if you to have that like high fence anymore. So then it's possible to feel a bit more like a landscape at the top. The building is kind of a rotation, and like looking from the bottom up to the top, it feels like as if it's curved, as if it's coming over, but it's actually still within the footprint. Okay, the competition started, and they briefed us, showed us all all the ideas of their plans of the massing of all the towers that they were planning to build, and showed us our site on the south side, 52 hectare for a master plan and 17 hectare for landscaping, and we developed like about 140,000 square meter of program. Like I explained earlier, like it's the simple rotation that we produced was the one of the Pearl River Delta and the axis of the city. And this was kind of like a result. You get like a slendering, like a tightening of the structure in the middle, because all the members are straight. So when you rotate them, you basically get like it's a ruled surface, it's called, and then you get like a tightening in the middle where you can actually do it in many different ways. The sophistication lies a little bit in that the first point is not connected with the first point, but the first point is connected with the seventh point. So if you have two ellipses above each other, then this point is not connected with this one, but like a little bit further on is it. And then you get like strange things going on when you start to rotate it. For us, it was also a way of that this rotation could control as many things as possible in one go. So the cost, important, the structural strength, and also the spatial qualities, like the amount of volume inside and the size of the floor plate. Particularly because it's so difficult to plan such a large project, it is handy if it was like a dynamic idea, so that we never really like had to abandon it, and there was in that sense less risk for the client, because they basically we could always turn it a little bit back, and therefore it would become cheaper, and because then the width in the middle becomes wider, and because it becomes wider, you have more space for core, and you have also, you need less steel in the middle. So it's kind of like a balance between between like cost and beauty. And it was already like clear when we, just after the negotiations, when we had our first negotiation with the client, when we went there, that they had made a little model themselves, actually playing with it. Which meant basically that they kind of like were hooked. They saw that there was was set up as like an experiment more than like an ad hoc design. There was a way of kind of controlling it and kind of like working on it. So it was at that time like kind of parametric before we really were using parametrics, because it was just coming up, and this was where most of it we still were doing by hand. But it was kind of thinking in the direction of how you could kind of design it parametrically. Yeah. Just some views, and this is kind of like the one of the early models. So it's just elastic strings between the top and the middle, and this is when you rotate it, like it becomes like tight in the middle. So on the outside, it's kind of further detailed. All the columns, first of all, they are tapered. So at the top they are about 1100, and at the bottom they're 2 meter. So it's like tapering like 50%. It's not necessary to have those big columns at the top. So you can taper them, but at the same time they have to be big enough because they have to be welded from the inside. Somebody has to go inside of the column and weld it close the gaps, because it's made of parts. All these are kind of like parts like this. And they are then fit first, placed in position above each other, and then welded. And like at the bottom, it takes about 24 hours to do a weld. It has to be done continuously, so they do it like with construction teams that work through the night, keep on welding, because then it's about 10 layers of weld, so it's about like a gap of 5 centimeters that they have to close. It's very interesting. Like, I think the whole process of construction is also interesting, because it gives you a real feel of what it really is like to do something like this. So the other parts, the nodes, basically, they were prepared in a factory in Shanghai. And they were kind of more put together by robots, and then they can internally in the factory they can check the welds, because they have to be checked by X-ray and so on, in order or sonar or something, like, in order to hear if there's some mistakes in it and so on. So so the difficult parts were made there, and then they were brought to site. But it's maybe that's something that I can go more into it later on. Like, this is how we explained all the steps to the client, that it was basically a simple idea. We had, at that time, we still had to compete with two other teams, like a French team and a German team. German had a rectangular building, it was much simpler, it was clear, no risk involved. The French had like a more tubular building, was a little bit more difficult and also slightly nicer, but like, and we were clearly like the most difficult one. So we also kind of made like work, produce work in order to explain to them that it was possible to do it, and that it was possible also to tweak it. And so all the steps, the density of all the rings was densified in the middle, also because the spans are then and they are smaller. And there it is like needs to be thicker, basically, because of the fact that it's such a tight waist in the middle. So we call our office information-based architecture. So we actually try also to work it out that it really is not only aesthetic, but it also really is necessary in some way. So this is part of the middle, and it also changes the space when you go up by the panoramic lifts through the tower. It changes from much more open and light into much more dense and like sort of structural, and then more open again. So it's in basically informing the whole journey up. And these were some of the early models of the competition models that we prepared. Like, and it looks like these verticals are all curved, but they're actually just straight. They're just from the bottom, they could just go from one side of the building to the other side. Like, the difficulty was actually to taper them well, because when you bend like 50 mil steel, it was very difficult to on a length of like 12 meter to have it only a few millimeter tapering, because all these pieces had to kind of fit together. Otherwise, you would be able to see it. Like, looking up, you would see the bubbles in it, in a way. And that was also initially kind of Arab, like our engineers that we worked together with, they they were thought it was good enough just to do this telescopic, just to do the steps. But like the client that is really great about this project, the really client at some point really stood on the fact that it was actual tapering. So that I think everything is possible if there's a will, basically, if somebody really wants it. I think this time, this project, we really had a client on our side. The difficulty, though, is that all the floor plans are different, orientated in size, so there's a lot of architectural work, kind of working out each plan, like it's never like a shortcut. So we did like many, many drawings of all the floor plans, and we also kind of rationalized the blocks of buildings that where there was enough floor place, and we moved them up and down in order to make the best use of them, like in relation to what program they in the end needed to be. And like in January 2005 we started, and we then had like a half a year to do to build or now to design the basement, like the whole foundation, because after half a year they were going to start with digging, because it would take them just 1 year digging the hole, and like and therefore we kind of like first initially kind of just did a very rough thing about what the tower would be, just concentrated on the logistics underground, like there's a 6-lane road near the waterfront, like, and there's a metro station, like I said, and a light railway, coach park on the side, because since all the Chinese tourists are coming with coaches, so that's on that side. There's a retail in the middle around the tower's footing, and a taxi drop off here, and then back to the garage, and so. So this was all solved with one deck, basically a landscape deck, that's still connected to the riverfront. And then, like, also covered all these infrastructure. Another difficulty was that the client wanted, like, an additional rotating restaurant, like a revolving restaurant at the top of the tower, while we had designed basically an elliptical tower, so it could never rotate. But we developed it in the end, like, with a ring, which would have to go around the core. And the difficulty in that sense is that the core still had to go through the waist, while we were also still wanting to have the most slender waist. So the core position is kind of fixed. So we had one person in the office continuously drawing cores, one after the other, starting from square to circular, then elliptical, then egg-shaped, because we needed basically all the space that there was in the waist in order to make the core work and put the lifts in. Also for the staircase, which is a double helix staircase, so that you can fold two inside of each other. And the other restraint was at the top, that this ring still had to rotate around it. So the complexity of everything kind of connecting with everything else was kind of like complex. So we had like a setback here. You can see the floor of the revolving restaurant. It's set back so that you basically also have a view more down to the ground. Sorry? Yeah, the laser point. Okay, yeah. Yes, there. So that's like just an example. The other things were kind of testing, was like they were concerned about the views, that the whole structure would actually obscure at some point the view. Our logic was that it is, since everybody is of a different length, it is always possible for smaller people to stand there and for taller people to stand there and look over it. Which is true, of course, because if you make it horizontal, it blocks the view for everyone down to one particular angle. So it's better to create diversity and like be able to kind of work with that. But it's difficult to convince people, because they think that things have to be in one way, the best way, while if you just create variety of ways, you have basically all much more, many more options. But like at the same time, it seems as if it's not designed, so it cannot be good. We had like big expert meetings during this project. They fly in all the structural engineers, landscape engineers, like architects all from whole China to check on this project. So there were kind of like meetings of about 150 people or so to get things basically through planning and or prepare to get them through planning. And you, as an architect, you basically feel quite just a small particle in this whole system. And it's also, I find through the whole process, I found it that you're basically never designing, but you're more negotiating. And like, you're also the only one talking your own language, your own way of like why you do things. And everybody else, like, they speak more, it's others' language. They basically, the language of logical argumentation, like, so all the engineers can convince each other because they can just make a point. But like for architects, it's very difficult to make a point because it's more like, yeah, I just know that it's gonna be ugly. So, and then but in the end, like, so I always was very kind of like, afraid for this whole thing, like for the fact that you lose control, that you have nothing to say. But in the end, it works out that they actually listen a lot to you, more than I expected. So now I thought maybe it would have been better, but was just a bit more relaxed and kind of would have kind of worked just more like on trust, it's gonna be all right in the end. So we also had like lots of other tests, like shadow test in the herbal relationship. So the effect of the wind on the whole. So this was wind tunnel test for to check on like how the wind circumstances were. For the wind tunnel test, they made loads of different models that were all tested. Usually tested in Shanghai, and like at some point they were even built like the waste portion, the weakest portion, in a 1 to 15 model, a steel model. They built it and then put it under pressure till it kind of collapsed, till it started to bend, and so in order to check if the analysis, all the theoretical analysis were correct. The analysis, of course, that the engineers all did, like Arab. Then we were looking for contractors, like steel contractors, and this was like steel proposal to make the beams so as they normally are made, which are with our vertical seam, but like in the end we made them like with just horizontal bent elements in one piece, so that it's not necessary to have all these seams. So these would be much more visible if you would have like a seam there and a seam there. And like the whole building was first built horizontally before it was shipped to Guangzhou and built vertically, because all the elements are different. So each, like for robots, is no problem because they're all kind of family, they all have a different angle, but more or less the same. And for robots, it's not a problem to weld them all differently or to weld them all exactly the same. So basically, this is just the nowadays technology that you can make use of, fabrication techniques and like, but they had to check it, like if it fit together, and then after it fit together, they shipped it, and the next part they actually checked, so in order to make sure there are lots of drawings made. And in November 2005, they started with the foundation. So they basically built a frame, that's this is generally the way of how it works in China. You just build a frame, concrete frame, and then they explode it out afterwards when the basement is built. So it's something like this. And then all the piles, 4 meter diameter, were dug by hand. So there's people just drilling like all this granite, and it is 40 meter deep. So they go 40 meter deep into the granite, and then they anchored diagonally, and there's some people like at the bottom kind of drilling away, like, and then mostly women, basically, they carry this up, like by just a hinging system, and carry it all out. Like it's unbelievable. This also has to do with the fact of how they make that frame. Like after that frame is there, you cannot really have big material or machines in there anymore. So they do the rest like with by hand. And this is one of the node elements, like one of the at the bottom, like how they when they arrived on site. So they're inside, they're all kind of like sheets to transfer the structural strength over the node. And this is like how they fit on site. The beginning. And like so how they are kind of placed. Then placed and then they fit together with steel elements, like that keep them apart. And then later on they're filled with concrete. So the verticals are, and it's for two reasons, because normally such a building has to have cladding, because you have fire protection, you need like enormous cladding, and fire protection on the outside is really dirty stuff, like that concrete stuff that they spray upon. And we were, because of the size of the building, it was possible to do actually a lot of research and convince them that it was not necessary, because of the fact that they filled with the concrete, the columns with concrete, that cools it during fire. And then there were kind of tests done, like how they behave during fire. And it was also because we have a setback from the facade and the structures on the outside, they were cool enough not to need any cladding. And this is like kind of like halfway the tower. When I'm going the wrong way. And here these places, the pieces that have to be welded in between are very small. And this is like after kind of like 2 years of construction, you see them all rusted already and like dirty with concrete. But actually like this very much like the way it looked like this. And this is the view just outside of, there's also, I'm standing now at the moment on such an island that sticks out, and that's the way of how everything is brought in. Like, so they bring it to this kind of diving planks and then they move it in, all the things like. It looks a little bit like a plant, I think, like the whole structure. And there was also special scaffolding made, so there's small platforms that are forking into the structure. And then they could kind of like lift it up and fork it in like higher. And on these, they built a little like a hut around the part that they had to weld in order to cover it from the elements. And it's the top ring and the top deck, which is 54 meter by 42 meter. And they're starting the mast. And then after that, they had to start cleaning it and painting it. So this is like the abseiling, the cleaning crew. And they basically with three of them, like around like a column, and then first with these rotating sanding machines, they clean all the dirt off, and then. Afterwards, like about 50 meter higher, there's the painting crew, and they paint everything. But yeah, of course, there's many layers of paint, like in most of them in the factory don't. So this is like the special kind of electro motor kind of rails made where they can kind of like sail along these. And then there's one guy keeping all the safety cords apart for the guys hanging below. It's painted, and the government that paid had to pay compensation for to clean all the cars and all the houses, like in the whole area, because there was an enormous cloud. I actually was photographing here, and immediately my whole camera was covered with paint. So. They're basically these guys are the real heroes of this building, I think. Like, it's quite unbelievable to the type of job that they did. The staircase that we thought up, like an external staircase where you could first, initially we designed it to be on the outside and on the inside of the rings directly, so that it would be really close to the structure. But later on, it was only possible to link to execute it actually if we would merge it with a safety staircase to for escape out of the elevators. So. Those are the observation decks. The kind of observation boxes, glass boxes that would stack through the structure so that you could also experience the outside. View up, that's a box like that. And that's the view down. And that's the restaurant. Like double, triple height, like and with two layers of rotating restaurant. And there's the conference rooms at the bottom. And that's the opening, like the opening of the Asian Games. And now it's kind of like become part of the city, basically. Okay, that's like that's basically my kind of like story. And now I have like kind of like off the end of the project, there's a kind of like there's a documentary made, like which is kind of recently shown on Dutch television, which kind of follows the last bit and then like on. So maybe that's nice to give you an impression of how we're struggling at the moment because it's kind of like awards and all documentary basically.
Some elastics and I was just kind of weaving something, but I didn't know what I was making.
Wow!
So I first thought, well, maybe I'm gonna make it circular. So I was just weaving a circle, and then I thought, no, that's not so nice. So I then rotated the top, and then I thought, hey, that's nice. And then we said, yes, let's make that one.
Je begint gewoon abstract, je realiseert je niet precies dat het stalen buizen gaan worden op dit moment. Dus het is in principe een principe van een vorm in relatie met iets wat zeg maar constructieve betekenis dan heeft. Het zijn gewoon de rechte lijnen die de krachten uiteindelijk naar de fundering brengen. Het zijn de lijnen die het gebouw met zijn karakter geven. Dus als je hem zo draait, zeg maar. Dan krijg je al een beetje de vorm erin. Dus je denkt het eerder mee van hoe kan je de vorm beïnvloeden. Kun je dat zeg maar niet plannen? Ik bedoel, je bent afhankelijk van wat er aangeboden wordt. Dus alle leuke projecten gaan in feite via competities. Dus je moet gewoon blijven kijken of er iets zit en dan blijven proberen. Het is een beetje, het heeft wel iets biologisch, gewoon heel veel proberen. En dan soms is het, heb je weer wat geluk en dan heb je raak. Verwarmend natuurlijk, als je
erin komt. Die kinderen, ja.
Het gebouw kinderen zo kan aanspreken.
Ja. He?
Want als je dan kijkt op die tekeningen, die hebben allemaal iets essentieels van de toren.
Ja.
Dus het kind weet precies wat de ingrediënten zijn. Architectuur in feite. Ja. Ze tekenen allemaal iets van de structuur en ze tekenen de vorm, iets van de vorm.
Ja. Ik vind het
ook sommigen zie je dat die er wat te veel brazing in hebben gedaan. Nee. Dus je kunt gewoon zien een functionele engineer in de dop. Die denkt van, ik kan het nog veel steviger maken. En dan zie je andere kinderen die doen juist zeg maar, meer van de esthetica. Die halen juist wat brazing weg. Zodat het nog wat luchtiger en leuker.
Dat vind ik heel grappig.
In feite moet je ook zelf een beetje als een kind denken. In feite. Dus, dat je gewoon geen voorbedachte manier hebt over hoe het moet en wat wel en wat niet en weet wat. Maar dat je helemaal open staat ten opzichte van wat je zou kunnen doen en wat alles kan. Ik denk dat het zeg maar, dat is het. Je moet proberen zoveel mogelijk kind te blijven in feite. Dat je eigenlijk met alles wat je leert en zo, gaat er allemaal een stukje ervan af. Dus daar verstikt het meer met meer knowledge en daarom sta je minder open voor andere dingen. Nou, zeg maar dat wat je zegt, zo van dat het jouw gebouw is, dat voel ik niet zo. Maar dat komt, zeg maar, als ik er buiten sta wel. Maar binnen is het toch, zeg maar, zijn er te veel dingen die je niet echt zo sterk voelt als zijnde van jouzelf. Dus alleen, zeg maar, globaal wat hier is, maar niet precies. En ik vind het, zeg maar, toch een heleboel dingen vind ik toch zo storend dat ik het heel moeilijk vind om dat doorheen te zien en dat dan je eigen te maken. Thank you. gewoon veel te druk. Er zitten veel te veel ideeën in als je hierachter kijkt. Hier met allemaal van die deuken in de wand en zo. Het lijkt net alsof het allemaal één idee is. Dus dat het raampatroon dan zo doorgaan gaat in de wand en in het plafond. Maar als er één concept is, dus bijvoorbeeld dus een spiraal, dan hoef je niet alles van een spiraal te maken. Of als je rond hebt, dan hoef je niet alles van rond te maken. Of als je dan zeg maar zo hier zo de driehoekige als thema stelt. Dat je dan het plafond met de driehoeken maakt, de vloertegels driehoekig. En dan zo'n driehoekige shelving system erachter en dat soort dingen. Dat is gewoon veel te makkelijk inderdaad. Gewoon dat concept maar overal doorheen voeren. En dat doet afbreuk aan het werkelijke idee wat erachter zit. Dus ik vind, omdat het deze driehoeken te veel lijken op de gevel, vind ik dat ze te veel in concurreren. Omdat het in feite net lijkt alsof wij dat gewoon zo gedacht hebben van, ga maar door met de driehoeken, doe maar driehoeken overal. En dan tegelijkertijd met het materiaal dat zo glimmend is en er zo ongelooflijk goedkoop uitziet. En dan ook nog gebogen ook, dat snijdt overal dwars doorheen. Snijden. Ja, het ziet er gewoon uit alsof iemand heeft zitten schetsen. Nou, dit irriteert me wel weer. Je zoekt naar het, zeg maar, het... En mijn diepere drijf hier. Ja. Ik weet niet of dat zo... Aan het begin van je carrière is niet zo geschikt moment om dat zo bloot te leggen wat je drijf hier is. Het is veel makkelijker als je 80 bent en terugkijkt en dan nog eens een keer zeggen van wat heb je nou eigenlijk gedaan en waarom. Maar ik vind zeg maar dat je... Als je in het begin van je carrière staat, kun je Fabia? Als je in het begin van je carrière staat, vind ik eigenlijk, dan komt het te veel bloot te liggen. Dus voor andere mensen te makkelijk om erop in te hakken. Als het er vervolgens niet uitkomt. Ik denk namelijk dat potentie schept ook een soort van verantwoordelijkheid. Dat als je zegt dat die potentie er is, dan moet je het ook eigenlijk gaan doen. Want anders... Ja, want anders zegt iedereen van ja, je zei wel dat het allemaal kon en dat het erin zat. Maar ik bedoel, wat is er nou eigenlijk van terechtgekomen? Dus inderdaad is er ook wel zoiets van dat als jij bepaalde dingen wil, dat het inderdaad ook, dat je dan voel je ook wel, ja, dan moet je dus ook, dan kun je niet zeg maar direct afhaken. Ik heb zeg maar, denk ik persoonlijk wel eens neiging om me af te haken. Dat ik denk van, jezus, het is gewoon, ik zie het gewoon helemaal niet meer zitten. Gewoon kappen ermee. Ja, ik vind dit wel heel erg mooi, want het grondvlak is eigenlijk heel erg groot, 60 bij 80 meter, maar het lijkt hier veel kleiner. Dus het lijkt nu echt alsof je op een soort van organische stengel staat. Ja, ik vind dat... Dit is het zo, ik ben nog niet eerder in deze observation box geweest, dus dit is de eerste keer.
Hier kun je in feite werken aan de stad van de toekomst. Dus je kunt iets van de toekomst maken. Dat is altijd veel leuker dan alleen maar iets inpassen in een bestaande situatie waarbij dat voornamelijk een referentiekader is van of het er netjes in past.
Je geniet van het bouwen. Dat heb ik sinds klein kind heb ik dat altijd gedaan. Dan bouwde ik met boeken een soort van gebouwen. Met een soort van een encyclopedie. Al die boeken zijn ongeveer hetzelfde. Dus dan kon je zeg maar hele mooie gebouwen van bouwen die dan groot was. En als het dan klaar was, dan ging mijn broertje ermee spelen met Playmobil erin bijvoorbeeld. Ik bedoel, ik heb nooit genoten van het resultaat van wat het af is en daar dan mee spelen. Daar is niks leuk aan. Maar het opbouwen daarvan, dat is leuk, want dan is het een open proces. Dan weet je nog niet wat het eind is. Dat is wel vermoeiend ook, want je bent zeg maar ook voortdurend bezorgd over of het wel gaat worden wat je wil. Maar het is...
Oeps. Hallo.
Do you need to turn
on
service now?
What service? No.
Turn on service. It open your door and close your windows.
No, it's fine.
Do you need water?
Water, that's nice, yeah.
Okay.
It's always nice. Yeah.
Okay.
Great, okay. Thank you very much.
Yep.
Sure, sure.
Hallo.
Hallo.
Er is weer heel veel gebeurd.
Ja, vertel.
Heb je mijn e-mails al gelezen?
Nee, want ik was de hele tijd onderweg en dus ik heb nog geen e-mail gekeken.
Nou ja, er zit echt wel een kans voor een project in vandaag. Ik heb twee projectontwikkelaars gesproken. Die laatste was wat kleinere. Dat ging een stuk beter al, de hele presentatie.
Ja.
En, dus daar waren we in onder de indruk, maar we hadden niet direct een nieuw project voor ons. Ze deden heel veel van die villa's. En ze vonden onze stijl erg modern. Dus ze wilden eigenlijk meer een soort, ook een soort van classical dingen. Zo'n beetje een soort van... van die hele ouderwetse achtige Chinese villa's bouwen ze dan dingen.
Ja.
Ze waren wel positief gestemd, dus...
Ja, hier gebeurt het, hè. Het is wel mooi, hè.
Okay. Can I introduce you to Mark, our COO? Oh, Mark Moran.
Hi.
And another Hello. Mark, right?
Are you? Nice to meet you. Very nice building you've done there. You know, we were hoping to open it as the tallest tower in the world, but Dubai beat us out. But we think it will be the most beautiful tower in the world.
Height is something that's very relative, isn't it?
Yes, it's true. It's very unique. Very unique. So.
Is this the first tower for you?
Yeah, definitely the first.
I mean,
not too shabby. So, good job first time round. Yeah. So.
Great.
So,
all right. Okay.
I'll let you meet with Roger.
Yes.
And we'll get you your beverage for you.
Okay.
Nice to meet you, and I'm sure I'll see you more often.
Nice
to
meet you.
See you.
De manier waarop wij zien dat die toren goed gerund kan worden, is inderdaad die adventure component is natuurlijk ook heel erg belangrijk. Want dat, we hebben bijvoorbeeld een internal skyjump, dat je naar beneden kunt springen. Je hebt de skywalk, geloof ik, van de 60e verdieping naar de 30e verdieping. External skywalk.
Ja.
Ja, met die glazen platen die je ertussen hebt, hebt liggen. Dan most probably de mass climb, denk ik. Dus er zijn verschillende dingen waar we aan het kijken zijn hoe we die adventure component in kunnen brengen. Ja. We zien ook als bijvoorbeeld de bridal business is heel groot in China. Dus wij zien ook bijvoorbeeld op een gegeven moment als we een wedding expo hebben om eventueel een hele grote strik om het gebouw te doen. Weet je wel, dat gewoon iedereen kan zien, dat is de wedding expo. Het is zo'n eye-catcher, dus je kunt je wedding market doen, je kunt je... Je regular banquets, je filmpremières, al dat soort gekke dingen. Je kunt de tower echt gaan gebruiken als een premium venue voor lokale visible events, zo te zeggen. Are you okay, Ethan? Thank you. Wonderful, thank you. Wonderful, thanks a lot.
Ja, leuk te horen, want hoe je tegenaan kijkt. Zeg maar proberen eruit te halen wat erin zit, in de zin van wat het je voor ideeën zeg maar levert, hè?
Ja.
Ja.
So proud to have your building right across from us. It's beautiful, and it's such an icon for us, and having that right outside of our door is quite amazing.
Yeah, I was the first thing that I was thinking about, like, is if it would maybe be possible to have something like a small exhibition in the lobby downstairs.
Yes,
that would be very interesting, I think.
I do too.
Because I think like this is a very nice place. For an exhibition, and you have the customers, I think, that would maybe be interested in our projects.
Yes.
So that's why I chose this place in a way.
Wow.
Here in the middle, basically, in this area where there are now these seats, would it be possible to remove some of these chairs out of this space or not?
It's a little difficult because if you can imagine at night, this area is completely occupied,
mm-hmm.
closer in the evening times, because tea is quite a big thing here in Canton, as yeah. you can imagine.
It should be completely separate from what you have here, so that you keep the hotel
right.
exactly the same. And once in a while there is an element and that it fits in, so that you would have, for instance, where it is possible, here one tube, there one tube. It's not possible to change that lighting during the exhibition.
To what?
To disconnect it and then put a different type of light there. Kom.
We hebben geen zwemster
vandaag,
hè?
Nee, we gaan ook niet zwemmen. Dat is het weer niet na. Ga je mee? Kom maar. We hebben hier wat volume nodig. Kom. Ja. Maar we willen ook niet echt, niet, eigenlijk willen we gewoon leuke opdrachten
ja,
hebben.
Ja, helemaal niet groot te zijn, gewoon iets...
Nou, dat bestond ik nou niet. Nee, ik bedoel, eigenlijk willen we gewoon leuke opdrachten.
Ja, leuk. Leuk.
Dus dan... Je selecteert in feite met je soort van... met je gedrag of met je wat je doet, selecteer je de opdrachtgevers van de toekomst. Dus die markt die er dan, als je de bepaalde dingen wil doen, dan moet je dus uiteindelijk die markt zien te vinden. Dus die mensen die dat willen wat jij wil aanbieden, die moet je dan zien te vinden. Dus dan ja, dat hoop je dan, zeg maar. Ik hoop dan dat dus als je, ik dacht altijd van als je nou één ding doet, wat datgene is wat je zou willen doen, dat daarna het makkelijker herkenbaar is voor als je voor opdrachtgevers van als we iets inderdaad iets anders willen, dan dat zou het mooiste zijn dat je speciaal naar jou toe komen omdat ze jou willen dat jij. Nu doen we de hele tijd competities en je hebt nooit een idee over hoe dat precies beoordeeld wordt, of dat helemaal open, transparant is en eerlijk en weet ik wat. Dus je weet dat nooit. Achteraf merk je altijd van, goh, is dat zo de uitslag? En denk van, goh, dat is wel weer toevallig, zeg maar, dat het precies ja. zo is. Dus dan... En dan denk je eigenlijk van, ben je dan elke keer suf dat je daar toch aan meedoet? Al die dingen. Dus we hebben nou eigenlijk best wel eens een keer behoefte om eens een keer geen competitie te doen. Dus wel eens een keer een directe opdracht eigenlijk. Maar goed, ja, ik bedoel, die markt die is ook niet, volgens mij niet in Nederland. Dus ik bedoel, als je dat wereldwijd, eigenlijk is al, zie je dan je vakgebied als een wereldwijd vakgebied. En dan moet je bepaalde mensen hebben die dus heel erg risicovolle nieuwe dingen willen doen. Ja, daar ook geld voor vrij willen maken en dat ook samen dat avontuur aangaan om dat te proberen te verwezenlijken. Nou, dus nou ja, waar is dat? Ja, dat is inderdaad niet hier. Dus,
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
I told you,
yeah, very right. Welcome.
Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome.
第七个问题，你跟我们这些合作感觉怎么样？在跟我们那个建设单位合作怎么样？你的合作很成功，我想问你有什么事情需要我帮忙帮你协调处理的没有？
Okay, how do you feel about the whole cooperative process with all these construction parties? Any difficulties that you would like the gentleman to help with?
First of all, I want to say that it felt like a one big family, that everybody's cooperating, and I think that is very different from like how it works in the West, that like there's a really like a group culture, like, but there's also, I think, like, because I've sometimes felt really, because I make only like a small part in this whole, sometimes I feel very alone in kind of in my direction of what where I would want the tower to go. So I'm now thinking about the beginning of the process, eh? And so I would like, as an architect or as a designer, I sometimes would have wished for more control and more influence or more security, that I can know that that the direction that we are going is probably or is going to be mine.
I will take care, right? Okay, 我记住刚才提的是七个问题，为了凑够八个问题的话呢，我提最后一个问题。
One more last question.
这个问题就是说，我们这个合作是非常良好的，我跟你也建立一种工作感情呢。 你如果对广州有合作的意愿的话呢，你想下来有什么好的建议，跟你开展进一步的合作？
This cooperation, you've built up very good relationship between you two. So the gentleman is asking if there are any projects you would like to develop in Guangzhou.
Oh. Well, that would be like I would really wish for to work on a museum. That would be my ultimate wish.
他最大的希望就是那个博物馆 museum.
Yeah, museum that would be my
博物馆。你投标了是吧？是不是投标了？不太清楚。你问他是不是参与投标了？
Or a cultural building, like more of a,
which museum?
Which one?
Well, I'm just kind of speaking from my heart about like what my desire would be. Like I don't know what are the possibilities, or but I would like to work on a public building, on like on a cultural building where I would be more involved in the whole interior design of the project as well as the exterior, so that I could make it more of a coherent whole project and not only kind of mainly be limited by working on the outside and the programming, but also doing the interior design.
Okay, 我帮你找一点机会。
He will find the opportunity for you.
Oh, thank you very much.
Mark?
Yeah?
I am confident that I almost translated all you've said to to Mr. Chen, but in an understandable
way. Yeah, well, it was more about how I felt during the whole process. It was not kind of criticism, but it was more like that sometimes you feel very alone, basically, in the whole process.
Yeah.
What is his position at the moment?
He is the main secretary to the mayor, who is completely in charge of construction in the city.
Mm-hmm.
So almost I would say he's the second top in the city.
Yeah.
So very...
Je voelt gewoon, als je elke keer dat je hier bent, volslagen andere wereld, je voelt gewoon die ambitie, die positiviteit, dat werken aan de toekomst en dat gewoon ook bereid zijn om dingen achter je te laten en ook bereid zijn om die risico's te nemen, fouten te maken, te leren. Ze zijn verschrikkelijk gefocust op ook werkelijk dingen van je te leren, niet... Ja, leren op de manier van ervaringen opdoen en alles wat goed is, pikken ze op. Dus dat vind ik ook heel erg open. Vooral als ze me zoals gisteren dan uitzicht geven op misschien een ander project. Dat vind ik wel heel erg leuk, want dan heb je ook weer iets om naar uit te kijken. Want het is natuurlijk wel gewoon echt misère nu op dit moment in Nederland. En voor ons is het recht gewoon keihard overleven. Je probeert gewoon deze jaren door te komen en dan hopen dat je een van degenen bent die dat kan overleven. Als je hem licht geeft, dan moet je het goed doen. Hij krijgt gewoon iets op zichzelf. Nee, ik vind de ligging dus erg mooi. Want meestal zijn gebouwen gewoon te dicht op elkaar. En hier zeg maar dat er hier een behoorlijke ruimte tussen is. En dat dit een rechthoekig gebouw is, hoekig. Dat niet ook rond en zo, dat vind ik wel mooi. Want daardoor komt het gewoon, dan zie je dat de vrije vormen zijn juist meer, omdat het er iets hoekig tegenover staat.
Ik voel mezelf met de dag Chinezen worden. Ik had altijd al een idee van dat ik iets meer met Aziaten had, omdat ze een bepaalde waardering voor sommige dingen hebben die ik dan zelf heb. Maar als ik die toren zie, dan zie ik gewoon, als ik gisteravond zag, dat is gewoon gestoord. Dat is gewoon, ja, dat is zo fout dat het weer goed is. En ik denk toch dat je ook als architect zeker, zit je toch heel snel een soort gevangen in een soort van straitjacket van opleiding. Waarbij je geleerd wordt dat witte ruimtes erg goed zijn. Dat strakke lijnen erg goed zijn. En vooral de rechte vierkante box. Want wat is die box handig. Daar heb je je IKEA's designerware en die kun je dan zo allemaal precies passen in de hoekjes. Alles netjes opgeruimd. Maar ja, daar gaat natuurlijk architectuur helemaal niet over. Want ik denk toch meer, Blade Runner. Ik denk toch meer van dat de toekomst hier veel meer dat Aziatische is. Van dat iedereen zo die stad inhebbert. Dat hier gewoon zo van helemaal gevormd is. Met de meest gekke dingen om elkaar heen. En dat je dan ondertussen overal gebeuren allerlei dingen. En de lichtjes gaan allemaal 's avonds aan en het flikkert en weet ik wat. Ja, ik bedoel, dat is volgens mij veel meer de toekomst. Dus ik denk dat het, dit luidt gewoon het eind van het modernisme in. En het hele postmodernisme slaan we over. Want dat ging nergens over. Dus dan heeft China, denk ik, een soort van eigen taal nodig. En ja, wij hebben geprobeerd met dit gebouw iets van... aan die taal bij te dragen. Zodat het hun eigen taal is in de zin van architectuur. En dat het geen kopie meer hoeft te zijn van het Westen. Waar ze bekend om staan natuurlijk, om alles altijd slecht te kopiëren. Maar dit is geen slechte kopie van een Westers gebouw. Dit is gewoon verslagen anders. En daarmee kunnen Chinezen deze toren helemaal eigen maken en daarmee wordt het ook echt representatief voor hun cultuur. En dat zou het meest geslaagde gebouw zou voor mij zijn, dat het gebouw geslaagd is. Ik denk dat het gelukt is. Op zoek naar andere opdrachten.
Ja, natuurlijk. Ja. Lukt een beetje?
Ja, gaat wel. Maar, ja. Het is niet de makkelijkste tijd hoor. Maar,
Nee. Ik kan me wel voorstellen. Ben je nu met een iconic project bezig? Of?
Nou, we zijn nog in de competitiefase. Ja? Met een museum in Polen bezig.
Oké.
Kost ons waarschijnlijk een paar jaar van ons leven, zeg maar. Want zo is het ook bij... Er werken natuurlijk gigantisch veel mensen aan mee. Maar... iedereen vindt zijn eigen deeltje het allerbelangrijkst. Dus iemand die wat uitrekent, die vindt het uitrekenen het allerbelangrijkste. Ik bedoel, die heeft het idee van het zou er niet staan als ik dat niet uitgerekend had. Maar dat is natuurlijk niet zo, want het kan ook iemand anders uitrekenen. En zo zeg maar zijn alle workers, die vinden dat ook. En terecht, ik bedoel, dat is ook het leuke van een project. Het is hartstikke geweldig dat iedereen er hartstikke trots op is om eraan gewerkt te hebben. Dus dat is precies de bedoeling in feite. Maar ik kan me natuurlijk ook nog wel heel goed herinneren dat we aan het begin echt, echt daar helemaal alleen stonden. En dat we het echt allemaal helemaal alleen konden doen. En dat dan op dat moment gewoon, ja, de constructeur die is dan gewoon op vakantie. Van, ja, jij hebt een prijs waar geen win, die ga je toch nooit winnen. Dan heb je toch geen enkele schijnvakant dat je hier ooit gaat winnen. Dus dan gaan mensen gaan gewoon op vakantie. Dan kan jij gewoon naar Londen vliegen om daar toch nog met iemand te praten. Om het toch nog op te lossen, zodat je tenminste genoeg feedback hebt om uiteindelijk die spullen te kunnen inleveren. Want de deadline gaan ze niet veranderen. Dus zeg maar, er zijn natuurlijk ook dat soort dingen gewoon. Dat er in het begin, dat heb jij gewoon alles gewoon door moeten doen. Ja, gewoon, ja, alles moet gewoon af. Dus, en kunnen ze nu allemaal wel zeggen van weet ik wat, ja, is het allemaal zo, hè? Maar omdat je dat ook in je eentje meemaakt, heeft ook niemand daar weet van, zeg maar, in feite. Nou, sowieso. Ik bedoel, Barbara die zat inderdaad tot op de dag dat ze moest bevallen om gewoon te werken. Hij zegt dat ook altijd, dat ze, zeg maar, als zij niet had gewerkt, dan was dit project er niet geweest. Nou, inderdaad, als we het hebben gedaan, hebben we het met z'n tweeën gedaan. En dan heb je ook nog inderdaad een heleboel mensen in je bureau werken die ook allemaal heel erg een bijdrage hebben geleverd. Want het was een gigantisch stressvolle tijd voor iedereen. En onze kinderen, die hebben ook wel flink gesufferd, denk ik. Want je werkt wel gewoon dag en nacht, dus je hebt echt maar ook minder aandacht. Nou, merge wij alles gewoon door elkaar. Maar ik denk dat Nina's eerste tijd, dat hij toch wel... dat ook mede door, dus bijvoorbeeld in het begin, dat ze vrij klein was en zo, dat wel ook te maken had met het feit dat er gewoon gigantisch hard gewerkt is. Dus,
Ik ben gestrest, Mark.
Ja, maar ja, god, het is gewoon als je hier zit en je krijgt al die developers de hele dag om je heen, dan merk je gewoon van, dit zijn allemaal mogelijkheden die eigenlijk allemaal niet helemaal serieus worden overwogen, omdat je weer terugvliegt.
Nee, dat is want, jouw eigen gevoel, Mark. Zij weten helemaal niet dat je terugvliegt.
Dus dat weten ze wel. Natuurlijk weten ze wel, dan vragen
ze. Ja, dan vragen ze naar. Maar ik bedoel, ze weten toch ook gewoon. Ik bedoel, dat is voornamelijk jij. Dat is niet
ik bedoel,
zo.
Als wij hier nou iemand hadden zien.
Dat is jouw eigen ding. Jij wil gewoon daar voortdurend zitten. Dat is het gewoon. Als een soort van geruststelling in je achterhoofd. Maar voor hun maakt het geen fluit uit. Het is heel vaak is dat zo. In communicatie met mensen. Dat er is iets uit jouw eigen gevoel. Waardoor je denkt dat andere mensen dat denken. Terwijl andere mensen denken het helemaal niet. Die denken waarschijnlijk terwijl ze met jou zitten te praten. Van, ik heb eigenlijk wel honger. Ik heb wel zin in dit of dat. Ja, terwijl dat is gewoon. Dan denken ze dat helemaal niet. Dat is gewoon jij.
Dat is ook vast zo.
Ja, dus mensen zijn heel simpel wat dat betreft. Er zijn gewoon heel vaak heel andere dingen. Daarom kijken ze een beetje chagrijnig van ik moet naar dit of dat. Of ik moest nog dat. Of, ja.
Oh ja.
Soms is het misschien wel een beetje zo, maar het zal hun geen fluit uitmaken of jij op neer vliegt. Want voor hetzelfde geld vlieg jij een week hier naartoe en een week ga je dan weer terug.
Dus dat... Nou, ze vinden het wel belangrijk dat je zeg maar input hebt in je projecten.
Ja, nou dan. Maar goed, om input te hebben in je projecten moet er ook een soort van rust zijn. En een moment, zeg maar, dan, als je te gestrest bent, dan heb je geen rust meer om over iets na te denken.
Nee, maar juffrouw Ans, nee. De kinderen hier, stop.
Nou, ik moet morgen weer vroeg
op,
anders stoppen
we er doorheen. Hoe ga je naar het vliegveld dan met de metro?
Ja, ik ga met de metro mee.
Waar gaat hij zo vroeg? Gaat hij wel zo vroeg dan?
Ja, ik kom voor Ik heb hier een lijstje gemaakt. Volgens mij moet ik hier om 7:30 bij het hotel vandaan.
Fanatisme, dat zat er voor mij heel vroeger al in. Daar ben ik heel veel op becommentariseerd over dat ik dat niet mocht uiten, want dat krijg je last van, dat zou je zeg maar schade van krijgen, want daar hebben mensen moeite mee. Maar ik heb dat nooit onderdrukt. Ik vind gewoon dat je datgene wat erin zit, moet je gewoon laten gaan. Dan krijg je het minste. Ik bedoel, je hebt nu misschien dan wel een meer stressvolle tijd, of ook al in je jeugd heb je precies hetzelfde. Op het moment, ik voer de gevechten op het moment dat ze er zijn. Dus zeg maar. Ja. En ik heb er elke keer spijt van als je een gevecht zeg maar, hebt onderdrukt. En dat komt meestal door andere druk op je uitvoeren van je mag dat niet uiten. Dan krijg je daar achteraf spijt van, omdat je dan terugkijkt op dat ogenblik en zegt van, nee, maar ik had dat toen gewoon moeten zeggen. Dus, je wilt in je leven iets doen, iets doen met je, zeg maar, met wat jij talent hebt of wat jij...
Ik zou dat gewoon hartstikke leuk vinden om daar nu een aantal jaren naartoe te gaan. Als je hier zo terugvliegt, dan denk je echt wel...
Ja, je moet daar dan wel een betalende opdracht hebben.
En dan lees ik in de krant, in de Volkskrant, die artikel dat Amsterdam nu alle bouwprojecten gemeente heeft stopgezet. Dan denk ik, wat doen we hier nog? Het is een soort van masochistische kant van ons gezin. Om je op de aller slechtste plaats in de aller slechtste omstandigheden te gaan zitten. Zodat je jezelf lekker slecht kan voelen. Omdat er helemaal geen werk voor je is. Geen vooruitzichten. Geen medewerkingen. Geen dingen. Het mooiste zou zijn Hongkong, wat mij betreft. Want dan heb je nog wel de voordelen van, weet ik wel, dat het allemaal wat...
Als je een opdracht in Europa kunt krijgen, ga je dat niet vanuit China doen. Dat lijkt me niet handig. Dus je wilt er feiten beide.
Maar als jij ondertussen een opdracht hier in Europa regelt, dan kunnen we erover denken. Guwei Lingdao, Guwei Xianxi, Nushu Nimenhao, Wu Feijiang Gaoxing, Yagandao Feijiang Rongxing, Guwei Lingdao,
Guwei
Xianxi, Nushu Nimenhao,
Guwei
各位领导, 各位先生, 女士, 你们好, 我非常高兴, 也感到非常荣幸, 能与大家一起见证这特别的日子。
我要大门上打开，开放好吧，开放好吧，等你拥抱过去，用了魔性，你就会爱上这里，旅馆的人心都是个人，请不用撤离。
各位领导，各位先生，各位女士，我非常高兴，也感到非常荣幸，能与大家一起见证这个别的日子。
Do you understand what I'm saying? Bezig was, kwam zo naast bestaan. Toen was net van nou, een jaar of twee, denk ik, ja. En die kwam zo naast bestaan en die zegt, mooi papa. Als je echt zou realiseren wat het allemaal voor implicaties heeft wat je verzonnen hebt, dan zou je niet meer durven om ermee door te gaan.
Hoe Chinees je wordt, dus ik vind het echt wel mooi.
Ja. Je begint er gewoon aan. Het lijkt gewoon een sprookje. Het lijkt gewoon een soort van onmogelijk. We hebben eigenlijk altijd gezegd van ja, je moet gewoon één keer, als je het doet, moet je het gewoon goed doen. En dan doe je gewoon. Het lijkt ook allemaal als een soort van, zoals anderen zeggen dat ook, dat het allemaal van een soort van geluk aan elkaar hangt. Maar dat is natuurlijk helemaal geen geluk of zo. Het is gewoon het feit van dat je besluit dat je zoiets wilt doen. Ik bedoel, dan doe je het gewoon en dan. In dit geval is het ook zo dat het volgens mij in ieder geval werkt als een katalysator. Precies wat we het liefste zouden willen.
dat je daardoor de hulp van anderen krijgt, dubbel en dwars, waardoor het zeg maar alleen maar beter wordt. En, ja, dat is, kan niet mooier zijn zeg maar, dan, dan dat je een ander stimuleert. En dat zie je ook nu als je kinderen ziet of weet ik wat, of je ziet gewoon mensen die worden soort van helemaal enthousiast. Ja, dan denk ik van ja, dat zou moeten inderdaad gebouwen zijn, dat je een soort van dromen krijgt door iets wat je ziet of verhaal wat je hoort, eigenlijk ons verhaal is een soort van verhaal. Het lijkt niet te kunnen, maar het kan toch. En dat hoort de ander ook allemaal te inspireren. En dat doet het ook volgens mij. Hè? Missie geslaagd.
Thanks to Mark, yeah, for the amazing
lecture. I don't know if it's on or not.
Is it on? I'm not sure. Thanks very much. I think you were about to say this already. Maybe we have some time for questions if there are some people that like to respond to what they just saw. Just raise your hand, I'll come running over with the microphone.
How this project affected, you know, well, what happened after this project. But that has already been basically shown in this very nice documentary, I think. So, which leaves...
We're still struggling.
No, well, I don't know about it. But no, I just wanted to say that I think it's a beautiful building structurally and... So yeah, I just wanted to say that it's a huge achievement. So not really a question, but a compliment, I guess.
Do you want to say more about that?
Yeah, it's of course like we also did like lots of other work during it, basically just to survive. So it's not like this is, I think, exceptional that you can do something where you can really put some of your main ideas in it. But at the moment, we're still searching still for the next opportunity where you can really make something like special. And I think like, but that can take a lot longer than you expected. I thought it would have been a little bit easier, but like it's the... It feels a little bit as if you're still in the same position as at the very, very beginning. You're still looking for the next client that wants to do something.
And so, personally, would you now rather have a small project, or would you want to have another big project?
Well, yeah, it's of course. I think in big projects there are other things that you can do. And since it's about the same amount of work, let's say, like it doesn't really, it's not completely true, but like also like when you make a smaller thing, the intensity with which you do it, the amount of hours that you put into it, is also a lot, relatively much more than in a bigger project maybe, because it's more efficient in a way. Then I'd rather do it where it's bigger, thus more influential. I think it's more interested. I'm more interested in a more influential project than just the size. But I think one aspect of a big size is that it is like, yeah, you will see it from different parts of the city. Therefore, it has a big impact. And why should all these enormous companies like SOM only build these buildings? They are not these people that are working there are not particularly talented or anything. It's just a big company, and so I feel like, huh? Okay. I don't want to particularly insult anybody who works for a big company, but I personally could do also something positive towards bigger projects, while smaller architects are not easily getting the opportunity to do projects like that. So you have to find, I think you have to invent kind of like a trick in order to get into the position that you get these type of projects. So it's kind of like cooperations, like that kind of thing, like something that, and that has a lot to do with the fact, I think, which I complained about on Dutch news and so on, like that there's a, with the European legislation of like doing a tendering process, you're often just checked on like your turnover, the reference projects. You have to do 5 of these buildings in the last 5 years or something in order to get on a short list. And often that is impossible, while that doesn't mean that you have nothing to deliver, that you don't have any content to deliver. So I think I think it should be similar to Wimbledon. There should be wild cards. There should be exceptions to the rule. So I think it's fine for security for clients that you set certain kind of minimum qualifications that you want. But I think like there should also still the possibility for somebody new to enter the podium. And I think that is like nowadays it's really, really difficult. In the 80s, Kohlhaas, all these big architects that we have nowadays, Zaha, so they made use of the fact that it was much more open at that time. But now with the European tendering process, it's basically you have to have done 5 schools in order to do a school, the next to figure. And there's lots of architects that are really happy about it because they have done schools before, and then they get all the schools everywhere constantly. So I think it's also not healthy for the architectural practice that everybody's just kind of like only doing the same thing over and over again. So that is a little bit like my background, why I kind of said something like this.
Is it the European Commission that's setting the bar too high?
I don't think that's a high bar.
It is.
I think it's a very low bar. I think judging it based on what you earned has no bearing on your architectural competency. I mean, it's very clearly, it's like, how much have you made?
It is a problem of structure. As soon as like somebody has thought up a rule, then from now on, everybody is always have to follow the rule because there is a rule. But like, they have not really thought through the consequences, like when they thought up this rule. There's just managers basically that have thought they wanted to make it more transparent, more objective, so that it was kind of a fairer competition for the whole Euro. Like it is, I'm just talking within Europe, but it actually is also exported outside Europe too. That you're checked mainly on turnover and reference projects. Well, I remember the time in the 80s, for instance, where all these kind of like interesting architects were established. They got just open competition for Cardiff Opera House, like just open competition. Everybody could participate, and then they picked the best projects, and they went through a second phase and so on. But like that's nowadays, it's not that way anymore.
Well, I think there's some other factors.
I mean, I thought you were kind of an exception.
It's changing, like, they're learning, basically. So when we were doing this competition, we had just a niche where we were, where it was possible to get on the short list, and now it's much more difficult because they are also asking for lots of, they're starting to copy that kind of whole system, like,
maybe can ask a quick question because the video was such an amazing insight in your life's sort of work and practice. And in relation to education nowadays, would you recommend students then to still try to start their own office, or do you think they should focus more on working in teams and trying to maybe join a bigger office? At what point in time would you say it would be a good time in your career as a developing student or young architect to make this jump to try and pursue individual projects, or do you think that the future is for bigger groups and teams? I think your competition as well was started as a team, no? With, together with Arab.
I think that is like, you just have to work with what is realistic. Like, so the context is basically asking from you to adapt and to think of a way. But it is, personally, I find it very difficult to work in teams, because like there's a like in bigger teams, it's quite difficult to get like a similar result. Like, because sometimes it's also necessary to have a individual kind of like direction. So, but like I think there's no other way than to do it like that. Like, but maybe architectural companies will develop in future more like fashion companies, that you have big companies and they need basically an artistic director, and then for a few years like that company is flavored by this one person that is kind of like starting to head that company. Because like in China for about this project, there's quite a fight going on between the big concerns to get the projects in, and like maybe that is the future for of how it. I can imagine that like in some ways, like if it would really work, that could in the future not really be so bad. Like if you, but
I wondered. You said about the Netherlands, like this is a complete misery, and there's nothing to do here, more or less. Or that's maybe a bit too direct. And then going to China, would that be the solution? Or I mean,
we actually went like a few years to China after this, because it's like some time ago when this video was shot. But like actually, so basically to try it out, basically to see if that makes a difference. Well, I've learned even more since I've kind of like lived there for a few years. So I start to understand even better like what to do and what not to do and what might affect.
So you went back to the Netherlands?
Yeah, we went back, yeah. And it also is a mix of personal situation kind of things also. But it is also that it, like when you are there, it is more difficult again, like because then you're part of the Chinese market, and that is like, I don't know, I did not go there basically to do just projects, just work, and like just run an office. Like I want to run a particular type of office that is doing interesting work. So I'm trying to find out the best strategy of to make that that type of office work. And I think like I have contact, I built out contacts, and I built out my kind of like my reputation and name in China, and now I can also do it from a distance, so I don't need to be there actually. And then
Hi, thanks for the lecture video, it's very enjoyable. I'm just curious, you said that you felt like you were making a contribution to China in a sort of creative, inspirational sense. But what other contribution do you think that architects can really make currently in China? And maybe that would stem partly from a criticism of what you see happening there in terms of the urban and architectural growth that's happening now.
Well, maybe the main contribution could be on a quality level. So because there's lots of buildings are quite deteriorating quite fast. Like sometimes buildings look like they are 50 years old and they're only like 10, 15 years old. So there's lots, like if you think about sustainability and about like the amount of material that is wasted because things are kind of like just bad quality. But I think it's not really up to architects to do something about it because it's the system of making money in China is to build, sell, and take your money. And like that since this is, since as long as that is happening, that is like what can you do? Because as soon as they've sold the houses or they sold the buildings, they're out, and then somebody else stuck with the below the quality, the level, basically.
If the developer offered you a housing project instead of a museum, would you be willing to take that in
yeah,
this context?
Yeah, of course. I think like everything is every project is interesting. Of course.
Yeah.
It would be very interesting. And I think that through such a project, you start to learn a lot about how it really works and what you can do. And my principal way of approaching it would be kind of similar, trying to understand and do it like sports, try and influence it in the right direction and not not bring my own luggage there or wouldn't come there with a ready-made design. I would just try and kind of influence and understand the processes.
Thanks.
Maybe one last question, or if there's no more burning questions, maybe we just finish there. And thank you very much for
thank you for having
the lecture
me.
And presentation. I saw there's some books just being set up over there as well. I don't know if there's a chance even to get them signed or get a chance to ask some questions in private if you want, but there's a stand right over there.
Interested, yeah. Okay.
Thank you. Okay.